It's the dream of poker pro and amateur alike to win an EPT event.
Peter the Former is the champion.
In five seasons, the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour has crowned 44 champions and paid out over 119 million euros in prize money to become the largest poker tour on the planet. And there's more up for grabs in Kiev this week as the remaining players duel for the title every player wants. Magnificent Kiev for the opening event of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour Season 6. A hotbed of poker talent, it's no wonder we've added another Eastern European venue to the tour. And what a debut Kiev has made. This is the largest poker tournament ever held in the Ukraine. And featured some of the world's elite. 296 competitors entered, paying 5,000 euros each, creating a whopping prize pool of over 1.3 million euros. First prize is 330,000 euros. And the man in the chip lead is Belarus's Vadim Markashevsky. He's been in the top three since day two.
I am playing for the first place, and for this reason I will be playing very aggressive every pot.
Maxim Lykov could be the man to watch though. His aggressive style won plaudits in our last program. And Alexei Maslov, 197k in chips at the start of the day, but making a move up the chip count now, is well aware of his main competition at the featured table.
Maxim Lykov is one of the best Russian players. Vadim Markashevsky, he is a great player. He earned $1 million in WCOOP in PokerStars.
So only 16 players remain. We have two tables of eight, that's one down here, and of course our featured table behind me. Play is just about to resume, but of course only the most resilient remain, all vying for their place in European poker history. There's plenty of play to come, but by the end of tonight we will have our final table of eight.
It's James Hartigan and Daniel Negreanu on commentary duties. The final table's in sight for these players now, Daniel. The prestige of being in the top eight and also the big money. That's when that gets paid out.
And I gotta say, I'm really excited about the types of players that we have here. Really sophisticated poker. The percentage of, you know, really strong players to kind of what I'd call weak luck sacks, if you will, is very high. The play's been very sophisticated here in Kiev.
This is a new face. This is the Polish player Lukasz Plichta. He's got king-queen off suit, and he's going to raise it up.
Looks like he's making it 30,000. And you could call this play relatively standard. You know, one of the great things I like about the EPT is they're eight-handed tables. Some other tournaments, they have nine- and ten-handed starts. But with eight, forces the action. Hand like ace-king now for Maslov in position. He's got a dilemma, and it's not fold. It's re-raise or call.
He announces call.
Electing to play it the small ball way.
Maxim Lykov will fold the button. Torsten Tent from Germany.
Well, this is big trouble potentially for Plichta. If he does flop a king, it's going to be difficult to get away from. A flop like king 8 deuce or king 8 3 could be big trouble.
Jonas Kronwetter has ace queen, and he is one of the short stacks, and he is going to be all in.
Well, look at this. Kronwetter, I like the move here. He's got a raise and a call, doing what's called the squeeze play. I expect to see, you know, a king-queen get out of the way, but Maslov, because he slow-played it, just called before flop, he's going to make the call, and he's got Kronwetter in bad shape here.
Yeah, Maslov likes his opponent's hand because he is a 3-to-1 favorite with five cards to come.
And here's the flop.
That's a good flop there from Maslov. Kronwitter has a couple backdoor draws. You know, he can catch a couple spades. He's got the ace of spades, a jack nine for a straight. But other than that, he's really looking for the queen.
Turn card takes away his draws, so it is just the queen. Three outs in the deck for Kronwitter to hit to survive.
Well, not much he can do now but wait, and the deuce on the river seals the deal.
He will be our 15th place finisher, 12,000 euros he'll collect, and we will not be seeing this Teddy KGB lookalike at our final table.
Well, like I said, I mean, the ace-queen there, I like the move. Ran into a hand, a little bit unlucky, but he can hold his head high, didn't do anything wrong.
And Maslov moves up to 972,000 in chips.
Welcome back to Kiev and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour, where we've just lost Alex Fitzgerald out to compatriot Andrew Mallett. 14 remain, and leading the way is the Belarusian Markashevsky. The top eight has a decidedly Eastern European feel. Russians, Poles, and in third spot, Alexander Dubchenko represents the home nation with pride.
So two tables of seven, blinds currently 6 and 12,000 with an ante of 1,000. And it'll be the Polish player Lukasz Plyszta who's under the gun.
Of course, we lost Kronwitter, so there'll be no small blind this hand. It's quite a mouthful. Some of the Russian names.
You're doing very well.
Well, Maslov is easy. Got that one down.
It's not like you haven't got Eastern European roots.
That's true. Action now on Tent.
He's on the button, and he's got 4-5 of diamonds.
Well, he is in position, got a suited connector. If he is going to raise with this, he does not want to hear the words re-raise. Up to 30,000 he goes.
Vadim Markashevsky also has suited connectors.
Well, and Vadim with a big stack of chips, a suited connector like this, at a seven-handed table against the button raise, expect at least a call. And that's exactly what he's going to do. He wants to see a flop with the 9-10 of hearts. A lot of good flops he could hit. He's actually got the best hand, little does he know. That would actually qualify as one of the good flops. Three nines for Vadim, but Tent has got absolutely nothing here. Just completely missed it. And he's not going to actually make the continuation bet. A lot of players would bet there with the 4-5. And now this is an interesting card for Tent because he's picked up a flush draw and a straight draw. So he went from drawing virtually dead to having a few outs now. Another check from Vadim.
Tent nods.
Well, he's really setting the trap. A check on the flop and another one on the turn. Will Tent bite with the draw?
Yellow chips, 5,000 each. He is betting 40,000 into the pot.
Well, you know, I can't blame him for the bet here. He picked up a really big draw. There's no real reason to think that Vadim is strong. He didn't re-raise before the flop. No bet on the flop. No bet on the turn. Looks like, he's putting up the white flag and saying, okay, Tent, take this pot. But we do know that that's not the case. He's got three nines. And he's considering a raise, it looks like. And that's what he's going to do. And it's 90,000 more to Tent. Tent makes a quick call there. No thought, really. You know, just hoping now to obviously hit the six or the diamond. Doesn't want to be the 10 of diamonds, though. That would give Vadim a full house. Okay, that could get Tent in a little bit of trouble. He's made two pair. He might put Vadim on some kind of a draw himself and maybe some sort of bluff. So a good size value bet here might get paid off by Tent. He's got to be suspicious. He's like, you check the flop, you check the turn, you got three nines, I don't buy it. Looks like he's reaching deep.
Markashevsky betting the blue chips, which are worth 10,000 each.
Well, a bet of 220,000. You see Tent just kind of sit back in his chair going, wait a minute now, all right. Let me just go through this hand here. I didn't hit my draw, but I did hit a little something-something. There are some hands I can beat. We know Markashevsky's an aggressive player. He's going to bet here if he missed his draw. You know, I wouldn't blame him for making the call here. It seems like a suspicious way to play three nines, and it's one of those spots also where you think, okay, he's either got a really big hand or my two fives is the best hand.
It's all or nothing.
It's one of those situations, and tough decision here for Tent, actually. What a good fold, actually. I know it seems silly to say that with just a pair of fives, but...
Hmm? He hits the nine.
No.
Well, look at this. He's on to something. He says, did you hit the nine? That's what it feels like, and he's absolutely right.
So a disciplined pass by Torsten Tenn, who qualified online for this event. He also won a seat to the World Series of Poker last year, but couldn't go because of his work commitments. He was very busy being a production manager for a large tire company in Germany.
I qualified online through frequency player points. The guys at work did not know that I play poker. They think that I am on vacation.
Well, that's not a complete lie. He's on a poker vacation.
Absolutely. Kiev, vacation spot. Play a little poker while you're here. That's one of the great things about the EPT. You play a tournament and you call it a vacation.
Time for Daniel and I to sweat. Not in the sauna sense, but in the sweat with Maxim Likov sense. We're going to play the hand from his perspective and only see his hole cards.
Okay, we're at a seven-handed table. Likov in early position, but seven deuce offsuit. Not a hand that I would play. And Likov just deciding, all right, I'm bored. Let me steal the blinds. Up to 30,000 with the worst starting hand in the deck.
He's been called by Torsten Tenn, and I'm really going to put my neck out here and suggest that Tenn is calling with a better hand than seven deuce.
Look at you. You're quite a gambler, aren't you?
Yeah.
So Likov's blind steal attempt. Not working so well so far. He's got some action from Tenn. And it also looks like Markuszewski is considering a call as well. He's looking over to see how many chips Likov has, and substantial amount. All right, he decides, nah, I'll get out of the way.
What about Plishta in the big blind? No, he doesn't see any value with those cards. So heads up to the flop.
All right, well, I'm going to be honest, this is not a good situation usually to be in. Seven deuce offsuit out of position against someone who's called a raise. And on the flop, you've got, nothing.
Hey, that's not going to stop this guy from betting. I guarantee it.
We shall see. He certainly is not going to win this pot unless he's able to bluff it. And he did raise before the flop, so he can represent something maybe and just hope that Tenn just missed the flop completely as well. So a bet of 38,000, and now look at Tenn just jump out of his chair, reaching for chips. He seems interested. And it looks like he's going to raise it up. So this should be the end of the hand. I don't know how Likov could justify continuing here. If I'm him, I'm thinking, okay, and I got caught. Just let's throw the hand in the muck, and that's what he's going to do. Yeah. Well, a good play there from Tenn. Very aggressive move there. He did not have a heart in his hand, just two sixes. Was the best hand and a good play.
And you can't blame Likov for trying. He's an aggressive young Russian. This is his first cash on the EPT. He also cashed in the World Series of Poker, amassing tournament earnings so far of nearly 105,000 euros. So what's his strategy today as one of the chip leaders?
Ну, я буду стараться выиграть фишку у всех игроков, независимо от того, сколько у них фишек. И буду играть на первое место.
I like that. He's going for the win. He's not here to ladder.
And be honest with you, you know, from watching him play so far in this tournament, he's got the right kind of style to do just that. Mixes it up. I really like the way he's playing. The seven deuce, I don't know, okay? But other than that, I've been very impressed with his play so far.
Queen nine, Markuszewski will let that one go. Plishta folds. This is Vitali Tolokonikov.
He picks up a 6-7 offsuit. Well, it looks like he's going to get involved here. You know, one of the things I've noticed about a lot of the Russian players, sort of a theme, is that they really mix it up well. You know, they play conservatively, but every once in a while they just say, okay, I'm going to make a move. It's really difficult to play against players who randomize like that. And another one you're looking at right here, Likov, has done that rather well.
He's in the big blind, and I don't think he's going to surrender it with king nine of clubs.
No, he's going to want to see a flop with this hand. You know, he could potentially re-raise, but it is a suited hand. You know, one of the things that you worry about when you play king nine is when it comes 10-jack-queen, you've got the king eye straight, but you have to worry about the ace king. It's not a threat here. He's up against 6-7 offsuit, but it often is, and it's a dangerous hand to play. Okay, well, this is a board that no players hit, so really it comes down to who wants it more. The most aggressive player is going to win this pot. Likov checks on over to Tolokonikov, who bets with the 6-7. You think he has to, pretty much. It's the only way he can win the pot. And now Likov just kind of glance over him, have a look, see if he thinks he's got anything. And he, you know, he's making the call here with king high. This is pretty good. Pretty good read so far on the hand. Turn of three. Doesn't change too much. Vitaly now with a gut shot straight draw. He can catch a five. Of course, a six or a seven.
Well,
pair him up and win the pot.
Has checked him again, and I think Vitaly's going to bet again.
Well, see, this is some really good poker here. He's firing the second bullet at it. The question is, will Likov make a call once again with just king high? You know, this is a tough spot to make a call. If the guy does have an ace, I mean, you're drawing completely dead. If he has a four, of course you're dead. But will Likov read through this second bullet from Tolokonikov? He's thinking about it. What amazing play here. He's just absolutely calling him down with king high. King nine high. Tolokonikov is probably going to think to himself, I got to give up now, don't I?
Well, the river's a blank. Likov has checked again. Is he going to fire a third and final time? Is he going to try and steal it on the river?
Well, obviously we know the only way he can win the pot here is with a bet. The question is, will it even work? We've seen Likov make an amazing call on the flop, a better call on the turn. You know, he might be dialed in. He may have some sort of physical tell. They've played a lot of poker against each other throughout the tournament. He just may have a dead read on him and is letting him bluff his chips off. And it looks like he's going for it.
Vitaly is counting out those chips.
Well, the pot over 250,000 already.
What's he going to make it? 160,000. And this is a tough decision for Likov.
This is fun. I'm really enjoying this hand. You're seeing two players play at a really, really high level. Both players know, you know, you've got nothing, but so do you. You've got nothing, too. The question is, whose nothing is better? Likov obviously does have the best hand with king high, but it would be a very difficult call to call the bet on the flop, another one on the turn, and then on the river. But he really, really is suspicious here with king high. Something in his gut is telling him, I don't know, this guy's just got nothing. Could be the call of the tournament if he's able to make it. Unbelievable.
He's made the call. A terrific call on the flop, a terrific call on the turn, and he calls on the river with just king high. Well, that is the hand of the tournament.
I'm speechless, to be honest with you. This is amazing. Both players really just played the hand well. Tolokonikov pushed three times. What are you supposed to do? You figure the guy's got nothing, you're right, and he still calls you with king high. Unbelievable read there. That's a boost of confidence for sure for Likov right now. No one's going to want to bluff that guy after that pot.
Incredible stuff.
You know, the EPT saw sort of the influx of the Scandinavian player, and more recently now we're seeing more and more of these Russians just really play at an elite level, and this is just an amazing hand we saw there. Wow.
Well, this is the very next hand. Action has been folded around to Arthur Simonian, who's been very quiet at our feature table, continues not to get involved.
Well, he'll have to if he wants to make a run at the final table. You can't just sit there and wait. Your chips dwindle. Here we go with Maslov raising with Jack Six of Hearts in position to 33,000. It's on the unbluffable. Likov with an ace. You know, he's been spot on with all of his reads so far. This time saying, okay, you know, I don't have to win every single pot. And he lets one go. Action over to Tent now. Picks up pocket eights. Well, against a late position raise, a lot of times these middle pairs are tough to play. You might want to just re-raise it and win it right away, sort of define your opponent's hand, because if you don't, a lot of times the flop comes out, queen, jack, four, you never really know where you're at. You're in no man's land.
Well, he has just flatted, so we're going to see a flop.
Okay, well, that's a decent flop for two eights. Only one overcard. Also, you've got the added bonus of having the straight draw if a six comes. For Maslov, he's just got the gut shot himself. He can catch a jack. But it looks like Tent likes the flop enough that he wants to be the first to bet it. That's exactly what he does. Look at this quick call. Did you notice that? Just I call. Real quick.
Huge call. I'll tell you what, though. Tent doesn't want to make three of a kind, does he?
Certainly not. An eight on the turn could create some fireworks. Maslov says, you're not buying this pot with one little bet on the flop. Turn a king. No help to either player. Now Tent has to be wondering, what does that quick call mean? Why did he do that? He made it very clear that, you know, he was letting him know, like, I call. And look at this. He's called. Oh. A lot of players call this a float.
Needs to be a bit more careful with his chips, though, Daniel. If they go over the line, they're in play.
Absolutely. It looked a little nervous. We know why. He's trying to steal this pot. Just called in the flop super quickly to kind of send the message that I really got something. And now the tent's checked. Looks like he's going to try and steal
95.
The pot.
Alexei,
bet of 95,000. Now a tough decision for Tent. He has the added outs. So if he feels like if he's beat, you know, he still may call thinking that, oh, I can catch a 6. I can probably catch an 8 and win this pot. Maslov just thinking, please fold. Tough decision here for Tent. And he is going to make the call. So we will go to the river. Over 400,000 in the pot already. 7, no help to either player. Action again, going to be on Tent. I don't see why he would bet now.
Sure enough, he checks.
And now the question, how Maslov didn't waste no time, just boom.
Every player at this table is just quite happy to fire out with absolutely nothing.
And look at this quick call.
Called so quickly. Maybe Tent's thinking, these Russians, they just love bluffing off their chips.
Well, I'll be honest with you. Despite the fact that Maslov lost the pot, I still think we're seeing really top-notch poker here with a lot of, you know, a lot of bluffing, a lot of thin calls, just a lot of really sort of, you know, high-level thinking.
Well, it looks like the players are going to go on a break. We're going to do the same. But before we do that, I was talking about being careful how you handle your chips. Let's see some guys who are experts in this particular field.
My name is Luca Pagano, I'm from Treviso, Italy.
My name is Dario Miniari, and I'm from Italy.
I'm gonna win it for sure.
I'm gonna do my best.
Go!
Luca is doing
it. I lost, that happens, that's the competition. Damn it, I'm so angry!
Welcome back to the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour from Kiev in the Ukraine. This is the first event of Season 6, and the tournament started with a bang thanks to these guys. And it's been all go since then.
And as we rejoin the action, there is a big one brewing on the outer table. It's Andrew Mallett against Alexander Dovzhenko. There is ace, queen, 4-9 on the board. Dovzhenko says all in. Mallett quickly calls, and Dovzhenko will show trip queens, two pairs, aces and fours for Mallett.
Wow, unlucky there for Mallett. Making aces up and running into three queens. Not much he can do here.
All of his chips are in the middle. Dovzhenko, of course, is the chip leader in the tournament right now, and he's about to consolidate that chip lead as Mallett goes out in 13th place.
So that elimination has catapulted Alexander to the top of the chip count. Top four are dominating proceedings with over 7 million between them. With only 9 million in play, that means the short stacks have some work to do if they want a shot at the title.
The blinds are now 8 and 16,000.
Our chip leader, after winning that pot, Dovzhenko.
And at our feature table, Maxim Likov has the chip lead with about 1.77 million. Here he is.
Very creative so far. It doesn't really matter. We saw him play the deuce 7 offsuit voluntarily. So I guess you'd have to throw a 7-5 into his range as well. Really likes to mix it up. Nobody did see the 7 deuce offsuit, so his image is still intact. And he's going to abuse it. He's going to go after the pot again with another raise up to 38,000.
38,000 is the raise from Max.
He's raising from the cutoff.
He's really just applying pressure, you know, but one of the things he's doing smartly is that while he's playing a lot of hands, he's not really risking huge sums unless he's got some dead read like he had with the king high, which is just amazing.
Torsten Tent has folded the button. Plishta has folded the small, so it's Tolokonikov in the big blind.
These two have battled before. This time, ace 10 of clubs for Tolokonikov. He took a big hit to Likov after his bluff didn't work, fired three streets. Looks like he might decide to re-raise this time and just kind of take the decision away and just, if you're all in, there's nothing left to decide. He's got a decent hand, ace 10 of clubs. Leekhoff just in there with two random cards, really. He's going to move it in.
He is one of the shorter stacks, sitting on about 253,000, and it'll be a quick pass by Maxim Leekhoff. Earlier on, Daniel, we were saying that some of these Russian names can be a little bit of a struggle. I have to say, I think you're doing relatively well.
Why, thank you very much.
How do you think the likes of Sean Deeb, Dario Minieri, Luca Pagano, and Katya Tharta would fare?
I don't know. I think Katya might be pretty good.
Well, let's find out if your prediction is correct.
Ivan Demidov, Russia.
Sean Deeb.
Cyril, Andrzej, Nicolas, Julie, it's...
Katya Tharta.
Surov, Andrei, Nikolayevich.
Luca Pagano.
Surov, Andrei, Nikolayevich.
Dario Minieri.
Surov, Andrei, Nikolayevich.
The correct pronunciation is Surov, Andrei, Nikolayevich.
Trasevesky, Andriyev, Borisovich.
Kazevsky. Kazevsky. Radzevsky, Andrei Borisovich.
Wow. Tracy versus Kidge, Andrzej Borowicz.
Trasevsky, Andrei Borisovich.
Correct pronunciation is Trasevsky, Andrei Borisovich.
Nalitov, Mikhail Andreevich.
Nelto, Mikhail, Andrew Wick.
Nalitov, Mikhail. Andreevich.
Nalito, Michael, Mikhail, Andreevich.
The correct pronunciation is Nalitov, Mikhail, Andreevich.
There's so many words that I've never, well, so many letters you never have in that order.
Well, you were right about Katya being good, but did you think Deeb would be that bad?
Sean Deeb, my goodness. That was too funny. Oh, boy.
Back to the action at our feature table as we play down to our final eight. We've lost a player from the outer table. We're going to lose Vitaly because he has to balance the other one. Two tables of five now.
Well, and that's when action really starts to get fast. We've already seen a lot of fast action, but five-handed tables, you really got to play. Otherwise, you just get dwindled down and, you know, you really don't have a chance to get to the final table with enough chips to make an impact. Looks like Leekhoff will be in the big blind.
So, Torsten Tent, UTG, first to act.
UTG standing for under the gun, right, for those that don't know that.
This is really weird, so I'm doing the poker talk and you're doing the translation?
Yeah, something like that. Well, you know, when you go online, a lot of these forums, everyone abbreviates everything. There's MTTs, UTG plus two. I don't even understand it, and I play poker for a living.
TY.
LOL. Queen 5 offsuit here for Maslov.
Been folded to him in the small blind, and he's going to play. He's going to call.
The option now to Max.
So Maxim Leekhoff could see a free flop.
Well, you know, the players got to respect Leekhoff a little once they see that he's capable of making a call with King High after three bullets were fired earlier.
Ace of clubs.
He's earned that
clubs,
respect. And this flop gives Leekhoff the best hand. He's got bottom pair. Maslov didn't connect at all. He's still got just the queen high. But he's first act. He's not going to bother trying to bluff Leekhoff.
And check. Turn card, please.
So Leekhoff happy to check his bottom pair. Turn is another club. No player has a club in their hand, so Maslov would need to catch a queen to win the pot, or, you know, he might try to bluff him. Like, that'll work. Okay.
16,000 is
16,000 from Maslov. Did you not watch the other hand?
He's decided to give it a go. You can't blame a guy for trying.
I don't know. I might surrender against Leekhoff after that and just bow and say, I am not worthy.
River card, please.
So Leekhoff makes the correct call here with the pair of eights.
Queen of spades.
Oh, that's how you do it. I see. So Maslov was betting on the draw, which was he was drawing to just a queen, and he's caught his queen. And you'd think now that he'd want to bet it. There was no bet from Leekhoff on the flop, so hard to give him an ace. You would think that queens are the best hand. But he's thinking about it. He's not really sure what he wants to do with this hand. On the turn, it was an easy decision. You know, you got called, you are pretty much beat. Now that you made the queens, you switch from bluffing to saying, well, maybe I got the best hand. Check on the river. Maslov says, ah, maybe I should have bet. Shows from the queen. Leacock just goes, okay, you know, big deal, I got rivered. No big deal.
So a pot of 74,000 for Maslov.
You see Maslov a little disgusted because he feels like he really should have bet that queen. So won the pot, but was frustrated by his check on the river. Still can't get over it.
Let's see who Michelle has managed to grab for a quick chat.
I'm joined by a very familiar face on the EPT circuit. That's pro Luca Bugano. Hello.
Ciao, Michelle. Welcome on board.
Oh, thank you very much. I found him in the crowd. You're a bit of a legend at these EPT events. Victory's kind of defeated you, though.
I didn't do very well this time here in Kiev, but I was actually looking to go deep. Who knows? Maybe next time.
Well, it's 11 caches, is it, in the EPT?
Yeah, 11 caches, 4 times final tables, and 0 victory.
Ouch!
Yet. Now, you've got deep in so many of these tournaments. For these guys, what's the next move? How should they be playing?
I think that the bubble time, especially now that we're getting very close to the TV table, to the final table, is really, really important. So I think that a strong player, a tough player, a player that has big stack, now should make some move, especially against players that actually are looking for to make the first final table, because, you know, everyone wants to make the final table and to become...
Excellent. Well, the words of the wise, I have to say. Thank you very much for talking to us, Luca. We're going to get right back to the action on our feature table.
And surprise, surprise, Maxim Leacock is raising it up again, but this time he's got a hand, he's got the goods.
Well, certainly five-handed, an ace-jack. You know, he's on a big stack.
Around to Alexei in the big blind.
He's going to obviously play an ace-jack. Action back over to Alexei now, who's got ace-eight of spades.
And I wouldn't blame him for playing back at Leacock.
Well, you know, here's the thing. Leacock is probably one of the better players left in the tournament. He's really in a comfort zone. He's not the guy that you like to try to make too many moves against. We saw what happened earlier when someone tried to make a move against him. It didn't work so well, so you want to be a little more cautious ball, sometimes 40, as well. So ace-8 of spades, Alexei just see the flop.
These two will go heads up to the flop.
Had he moved all in, you know, Leacock was liable to call. Who knows?
Clubs,
ooh,
ooh.
Here
clubs,
could be some trouble for Maslov. They both flopped aces, but Leacock, with the better kicker, he's got the jack. They both are going to check. Okay, sneaky, sneaky. Whoa, there we go. That'll do it. Leacock absolutely has him destroyed now with aces and jacks. He checked the flop, hit the perfect card on the turn. We could see some fireworks here now. Leacock thinking about, well, there's almost 100,000 in the pot. How do I bet this thing? I want to get called. I don't want to make it too cheap. So he decides finally on right about half the pot, 52,000. It's clearly a small enough bet where there's just no way Maslov is going to just fold now. He has to call or raise. There's no way he can know that he's up against aces and jacks and that he's drawing dead. He does seem to be worried, though. Maybe he thinks, you know, well, he checked on the flop. That kind of scared me. A lot of time, certain players, when they have nothing, they always bet.
He says raise.
Alexei announces raise.
Well, Alexei going to get himself into some trouble here. This is going to be trouble. He's made it 170,000, so it's another 118,000 for Leacock to call. That has to be music to his ears. The only hand that could have Leacock beat is a set. And he says, no, 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 you don't have that. I'm all in. Now Maslov has to guess. He has to guess if his opponent is on some kind of a draw, maybe like queen, ten of clubs, or if he's got a better ace or a set or something along those lines. He's invested so many chips already.
He's called it. No. I guess because he's put so much in already.
Well, that's the reason why he probably doesn't need to go for the check raise on the turn there. He did that, basically committed himself. If he check called the turn, you know, he might have got away from it and still been alive, but he's got no card in the deck that can help him.
No, he is drawing completely dead. He will be out in 10th place, and that means we're going to redraw for seats because the final nine are going to be seated around our TV table, and then when we lose another player, we'll have our final table, our final eight.
So far, Leacock doing everything right.
Time to break the outer table then and focus all our attention on the set. 9 players remain, but there are only 8 seats at an EPT final table. We need to lose one more player tonight.
Let's play poker and win.
The top 4 have all the chips, while Russian Arthur Simonyan desperately needed some action. And he found some after just 2 hands. He pushed with ace-jack and got a call from Maxim Lykov with ace-3. The board helped no one, so the best hand held up. A timely double up for Simeon.
Oh, I don't think so.
As we rejoin the action, Dovchenko is still in the lead with Markashevsky right behind him. Lykov has lost a bit, but it's Simeon, Mayberg and Tolokonikov still in the danger zone.
Line still 8-16, nine-handed action. Have to make that adjustment, don't you? Suddenly you've been playing shorthanded poker and then you've got a full table.
It really is a major adjustment. Just the style of play five-hand is so much different than nine. You'll start to see people just tighten up now. They don't have that same sort of pressure they did earlier, except for this guy who he could care less how many people are at the table. He's raising it up with queen, seven of spades from early position. But generally speaking, the more players at the table, you know, the blinds are not coming around as quickly. You can be a little more patient. Sort of benefits the short stacks. At a short-handed table, short stacks are just getting hammered.
Got a few new faces at the feature table, including Adrian Sharp.
Well, here's a man who has not played a hand five-handed, nine-handed, 15-handed. Simonian finally picking up a pair of jacks. And if he doesn't play this one, I just don't know what he's doing here. You know, you would think against an aggressive player like Lykov, he's been paying attention. He's got to know that just because he raised from early position doesn't mean he has a big hand. And he's just calling. Okay, so playing it just cautiously. Possibly doing, you know, what Luca Pagano talked about in his interview. He said, you know, a lot of times people just really desperately want to make that final table and they'll play cautiously.
Pocket eights for Torsten Tent.
Okay, so with a raise and a call. Tent now in the blind with two eights.
Got it. All in.
All in.
All in.
He's looking only at Simonian. He's like, well, wait a minute.
Wow.
Ooh, you didn't see that, did you? Incredible. So Tent, I think he thought he was up against just Simonian.
Max will go ahead and pass. Back to Arthur. Strong.
Well, he's got rid of Lykov now. He is now up against Simonian, and this would cost Simonian everything he's got.
Well, you know what? Based on that reaction, Tent was so shocked and was like, oh, oops. You have to sense some weakness based on that. There's a little bit of a tell. So Simonian should really read through this and realize that with these two jacks, he's got a call. It didn't look like Tent had aces based on his reaction when he said, oh, oops. Lykov's in there. Unless he's a great actor, you know, which is also possible.
Cool. He's made the call. I'm actually a bit surprised he thought as long as he did, but his tournament is on the line. That said, he is 4-1 favorite.
Yeah, he's got a chance now to win a pot. Has over 660,000 in it, so sometimes tight is right. He's got to hold off the two eights. A big favorite here. Great flop for the jacks. Simonian's taken away one of Tent's outs. Tent would need to catch an eight that is not a diamond. Diamond on the turn would seal the deal.
Turn card is the queen of hearts.
Queen on the turn. So one card, you see just 2%
just needs to dodge
for Tent.
The eight of spades, and he will double through
one
here.
Card and one card only.
River card.
The river card is three. The jacks are good. Simonian doubles up.
So kind of a weird hand. Tent just really not realizing what was going on there. And if he would have just called before the flop, he would have avoided this big mess right here.
To Kiev and the first leg of the European Poker Tour Season 6. This event attracted 296 of Europe's finest players to the Kiev Sporting Palace. The likes of Ivan Demidov, Dario Minieri, Gus Hansen and Katja Theta failed to make it past day two. It really was a tough field. And now just one table of nine remains.
The story so far, Lykov raised pre-flop to 50,000, called by Markashevsky and Schapp. The flop is 9-8-3.
So an interesting flop here. Lykov in there with another kind of bad hand before the flop, but he's got an open and straight draw. Needs a 10. There's two 10s gone. A 5 would also do it for him. Schapp just needing a 6 to make his inside straight.
Markashevsky, of course, out in front with the overpair.
But Lykov, liking what he sees in the flop, decides he's going to take a stab at it on a semi-bluff, betting 88,000. Markashevsky, a good flop for 10s, three undercards against an aggressive player like Lykov. Got to like the situation and position.
Raise to 200,000 straight from Vadim.
Okay. I like this raise size. He's putting the pressure on, trying to protect his two 10s.
Well, he got Adrian Sharp to fold his draw, so now back on the pre-flop aggressor.
Well, a couple ways Lykov could go here. If he senses weakness, he might make a play here and re-raise and try to represent something strong. Or he may just elect to play carefully, hit it, and maybe win a monster pot off Markuszewski. A 10 on the turn. Wow, that would create some fireworks. And it looks like he's decided he's just going to call, so he's elected to play carefully. He wants to catch his straight first before putting any more chips in the pot.
The turn card is a unbelievable. Five.
Wow.
And Leekov makes his straight.
Huge card for Leekov. Now he's checking again over to Markuszewski, really hoping to see Markuszewski bet. At this point, he could care less what he has. He just wants to get chips in the pot, but Markuszewski's smart to check there on the turn. Well, that's an interesting card now because it has to scare Markuszewski even more. You know, not only now is, you know, he can't beat 6-7, obviously. He can't beat an 8, and he can't beat a flush, and he can't beat jacks or higher. So kind of dodged a bullet, if you will, with that card. Not a great card for Leekov either. He can't like what he sees. You know, he might think Markuszewski made this flush now on the river. Almost 600,000 in the pot. You'd have to think Leekov wants to value bet his straight, though. But now he's got to be thinking through past hands against Markuszewski and go, well, what kind of hand does this guy have? What will he pay me off with? And he decided to check it. Okay, so that last card did worry him. It paired the board, put the spade out. And now Markuszewski looking to make the value bet with the worst hand.
And Leekov was in check call mode. And he will show the straight. And Markuszewski's thinking, I could have just checked it down.
Well, I'll tell you what, Leekov is putting on a masterclass in small ball right now. There, you know, playing it carefully. He still got the bet in on the river, but he didn't jeopardize, you know, playing a really big pot in a marginal situation. Very well done. Very impressive so far. Can't blame Markuszewski. Really an overpair. Gotta think it might be good. Threw out 200,000, got the bad news.
Well, the blinds are 10 and 20,000. Markuszewski still with the chip lead. The short stack is the Polish player, Lukasz Plyszta.
Markuszewski may be the chip leader, but on his heels is Leekov.
Well, the action is going to be on Michael Myberg, one of two German players at this table. And he's not too comfortable in chips right now, 346,000.
Well, we've seen Leekov play a 6-7. We've seen him play a 7-deuce. We've seen him play a queen-7, a jack-10, and he folds it. So really just mixing it up.
Alexander Dovzhenko with the sevens, pumps it up to 50,000.
Didn't waste much time, looked down at a pair and popped it up.
Folds it around to the short stack, Plyszta, jack-9 of hearts.
Well, I mean, if he had more chips, he might want to see a flop there, but when you're on the short stack, you don't really have the luxury of seeing flops. It's usually all or nothing. Jack-9 of hearts, not the hand to do it with.
Just a big blind to get through. Torsten Tent has king-jack, and he is going to call and defend his blind.
Didn't take too much time to think about that. King-jack of diamonds, definitely want to see a flop. And there's a flop. Dovzhenko flopping a set. Tent really has nothing. He's just got a gut shot straight draw. But it looks like he's reaching. He wants to semi-bluff, and that's what he's going to do. So music to Dovzhenko's ears right now, a 70,000 bet right at him. Now he's hoping that Tent has an ace, that he's got him totally trapped. Question is, does he raise him now, or does he let Tent continue to bluff at the turn?
Give him the rope and let him hang himself.
Exactly. There are a couple draws out there as well, so you can make a case for raising.
Boom,
unbelievable.
He makes the straight on the turn.
Incredible. So as it turns out, if Dovzhenko would have raised the flop, he probably would have won it. Not to say it was a mistake. Tent firing out a bluff at the flop and now just hitting a miracle straight on the turn. We are going to see some fireworks.
Question is, how big is this pot going to get? How much is Tent going to bet on the turn?
Well, like I said, I wouldn't be surprised to see all the chips go in the middle.
220,000.
Bet of 220,000 from Tent with a set of sevens now and a three-card straight up there. Dovzhenko says all in.
Call.
Yeah, I would think you're going to call. You have the nuts,
Torsten
Tent.
Shows King Jack for a nut straight. Three sevens from Alex.
Don't pay the board.
What a turn card. Dovzhenko thought he was in the driver's seat.
Torsten is the at-risk player.
Tent can't even look.
In the lead with an
how tense is this? He does not want to see that board pair. Sevens.
Everyone just in shock.
Let's see the river card.
Crazy turn of events here.
It's eight of spades.
No, it's not going to happen.
Okay, Torsten, you can turn around. You can calm down. You're still in the tournament. You've doubled up. Job's a good one.
Well, that double up put Torsten into third place in the chip count. Leekov and Markuszewski still leading the pack, though. Nine-handed action continued with little major chip movement for the next 30 hands until Torsten got himself into a huge pot with chip leader Maxim. Torsten woke up with pocket eights and raised. Maxim is only cooler. Hitting a set on the flop, he bet again, and Maxim called.
Check.
He check-called the turn and the river.
Call.
Only to discover that Maxim had rivered the straight and taken over a million of his chips. So Torsten's stack was left critical, and Lucas didn't have much more. That is until a fortuitous double-up threw Vadim two hands later. This is a situation going into the 67th hand of nine-handed play.
And I suppose we shouldn't be surprised about how long this nine-handed session has lasted, because everyone wants to come back tomorrow for the final.
Yeah, but on top of that, we've just seen some amazing poker, some amazing hands, some of the best, you know, poker I've seen on the EPT in all the broadcasts I've done, been a part of.
So you're glad we've come to Kiev, then?
Yeah, absolutely. Some great poker. If you're a poker fan, you got to be loving this. Folded around to Tent now, who looks a little disgusted to not have more chips.
The other German player, Michael Myberg, another short stack, has sevens.
Well, frankly, this Michael short on chips, he's got one move and one move only, and he's making it. Myberg moving all in with the sevens. Got to be the aggressor in this spot.
One man who's not short of chips is Dovzhenko, but he will pass. Instead, it's Vitaly Tolokonikov.
One time. If you fold suit connected on bottom, what do you have now?
There's an ace. To ace 10, I think he's going to make the call, and he does. Okay, so I can't blame him for calling with ace 10. We're going to have a coin flip situation. Two sevens against ace 10.
Myberg is the marginal favorite going to the flop, but he'll need those sevens to hold up, or we will have our final table.
If something tells me that the rest of the table, rooting for an ace or a 10 on the flop, they want to get down to the final table.
Yeah, they're saying on the inside, ace, 10, ace, 10.
And some may say it out loud.
That would just be plain rude.
Eh. Here comes the flop, and that's a good one for those rooting, because a pair of 10s there for Tolokonikov. Myberg in big trouble now, needing to catch a 7 on the turn of the river.
Turn is a 5 of clubs.
One card remaining. It's going to have to be a 7. Otherwise, our final table is set.
We've been here before. Two outs in the deck. A 7 needed for Myberg. And it doesn't come. The 8 is a blank. Michael Myberg is eliminated in ninth. He'll collect €23,000. And importantly, we are down to 8. Ladies and gentlemen, we have our final table here at EPT Kiev.
So these are our final 8 players. Maxim Lykov has a commanding chip lead and will no doubt be using it to his advantage. But he should expect fierce competition from Markashevsky and Dovzhenko, who have the chips to fight back. After an absolutely cracking day's play, it is time to say goodnight from Kiev. The first final table of the EPT Season 6 is just around the corner. I can't wait, and neither can our final 8. Don't miss it, because next time we'll be crowning the Kiev champion. Next time on the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour, it's final table time in Kiev.
Looking forward to play this very aggressive and interesting final table.
Everyone can win.
It's the trophy they'll do anything to get their hands on.
Ow.